We're not waiting for people to actually make some changes. We're gonna do it ourselves. It's our turn now. Everyone is excited because we know that we're so close to actually getting it done. That's why I have that energy to keep on going.
I love hearing that optimism. You're getting me excited about it.
My name is Jerome Foster II. I'm 18 years old and I'm a climate activist. I grew up in Southeast Washington, D.C. I had a big backyard. It just had creeks and nature and animals there, and that was the environment that I grew up in. I was definitely a proficient daydreamer. I was just a pretty introverted kid, either in my books or just outside. It was learning about what life was on the planet and learning about astrophysics and quantum physics as well. I loved understanding how the world worked.
So can I just paraphrase what you just said? While other kids were watching Pokemon, you were doing astrophysics, is that right?
I guess you can put it like that, I guess. My parents have been a huge support for me. And they've just always pushed me to be as hardworking as I can be, especially for climate change. It has to be solved within my lifetime because this is the last lifetime to fix it.
The climate clock represents how much time we have left
before we start reaching irreversible feedback loops. But after that, we start quickly hitting other feedback loops that we don't anticipate, and we don't want that to be our future. It's not a job. As an activist, it's everything that I think about. I start the day, I just check emails. I check in with the team to see the work that we're doing in civic education. Typically from 10 to 12, I have a class. I have a lunch break where normally it's not a lunch break. In the afternoon, I'm doing an interview, speaking with other activists. Literally, I'm always writing an essay. My cat is my fun. She tells me when to take a break. She'll lay on my keyboard and stares at me. She's like, dude, get up. I'm doing great. How are you?
Jerome, how do you find time to have breakfast in the morning?
It is pretty crazy. I actually probably don't get as much sleep as I should, but it's the thrill. It's the thrill of making an impact.
And I think they're filming you for this live.
Yes.
Tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah, they're filming about some of the communities across New York City that have been impacted by the climate crisis. It's a lot to take in because I know it's going to continue to be the norm.
Maybe you could tell us a little bit more about the White House Environmental Justice Advisory Council.
Yes, so we work directly on addressing environmental racism. People don't really see the environment as a justice issue. They just see it as a science and technology issue. But environmental justice is about equity. How do we provide resources to communities that are hit the most by climate change? We can't just slap a solar panel on the climate crisis and expect everyone to be okay. So say this community that I'm in right now, in Coney Island, in Seagate, there was about $12 billion of damage. Communities that are at the front line, at the shores of this crisis, right here in New York City, we're still rebuilding. I was in fourth grade when this happened. This is 9 years ago. I'm now a freshman in college and it still hasn't been fixed. That's really what we're talking about when it comes to environmental racism, how it compounds on indigenous and black economic inequalities. We're trying to figure out more ways and more strategies to kind of highlight these stories in a new way.
It's always such a pleasure to hear from you. You give me hope. Good luck, man.
Thank you. Yeah, good luck. From my perspective of Generation Z, technology is how we connect with other people. I started out in middle school using social media to post about some of the key understandings of climate change, or whether it was through virtual reality, to really delve deep into someone else's experience as a way to build empathy. In the past 5 years, we've seen the effect of drought and temperatures that are unbearable for people to live sustainably. And that's exacerbated the violence that's been there, and that's led to migration to other countries that are seen as more stable, like the United States. When we look at the fact that there are just people looking for a safer place, then you understand and have compassion. I did a lot of exercises about learning empathy and not just starting from the idea that you're blue or red, but understanding that you just have values and let's talk about the values that you have and understand where the rift is. We don't want climate change to be partisanized. With the climate strikes, we saw young people in every single country in the world stand up. When you have an entire generation united in this way, that means that you can't continue to ignore this. And I think that's really the tectonic shift that we've seen now. Because we're done just marching and people ignoring us. They expect marches. It's a company just thinking, oh, they're gonna do that and they're gonna go. Let's let them do their civil disobedience.
They can ride it out.
Exactly. As soon as they think we're done, we're coming back. As the climate clock continues to tick down and we have less and less time to take action, we have to be bolder in how we're doing this. We aren't saying we have to go back to the Stone Age. We're saying that we wanna move forward. We're saying we're gonna embrace technology and make sure that things are more fair for countries that have been impacted so heavily by colonialism compounded on top of climate change. Just think about the impact that you have as one person and think that you're really just like a superhero. Like, think about it like that. You have so much power because everyone in the future will be looking at you in this moment and say, what did they do to actually make a difference? If we continue to build and retrofit our country and the world to be prepared for the future, then everyone in the future will look to us and say, they were bold enough and they were brave enough to actually make the changes that were necessary. We've been at the precipice of large crises. We've had large goals before, but every large goal requires you to be a part of that solution. Every single person who thinks that they don't have that ambition or drive, you can do that. You understand what's going on. Now you just have to do it.
Oh, crap. Got 5 emails already.